Jack was 15, and he was a very popular kid. He was very athletic. He played lacrosse, and he was the goalie, so he was able to take a lot and very proud of that. He was funny, just the life of our family, just really funny kid. And as we knew that he was a kind person, and as we found out later, he was even more amazing than we thought. And we already thought he was amazing.
Welcome to The Second Act, a monthly video series introducing you to interesting people with really interesting stories. Every guest has a connection to organ and tissue donation and transplantation. I'm your host, Brianna DiPilato, and today you're going to meet Rick and Jeanine Padilla. Now, if you're in the Denver metro area, you may recognize the Padillas from some local news reports over the last few years, or just from being out in the community sharing their son Jack's story. We'll get to Jack's story in just a moment, but before we do, I want everyone to know that we do touch on the topic of suicide in this video. So let's get to it. This month's The Second Act video with Rick and Jeanine Padilla.
He was very outgoing, very well-liked. He was an empath. The stories we learn about how Jack helped so many kids, phenomenal. As late as, 2 weeks ago, Jack's the second year he had passed, we dedicated a bench and a tree to him in a park where he played lacrosse and football, and had a mom say to us that Jack saved her daughter's life by really reaching out to her when he saw her struggling in middle school. And we've heard countless stories about Jack's empathy towards others.
So how does it feel when you hear some of these stories about how he's touched so many people beyond those that you already thought he touched?
I don't know. It does give us a warm feeling. It makes me sad, you know, that a person like that is gone from the world, because we can certainly use more people like that.
Share with us whatever you're comfortable with sharing about Jack and when he passed, and then days after he passed, when we led to organ donation and tissue donation, and his amazing gift of life lives on.
Our older son, John, was skiing with Jack over the holidays. And John said they were on the lift and just, you know, chit-chatting about this and that, and his brothers do. And Jack said that should something ever happen to him, he wanted to be an organ donor. John said, sure, okay. And John told us that while we were in the hospital with Jack, and Jack was in the hospital for 7 or 8 days. Or 8 days,
yeah,
before he passed. And we told the staff that what Jack's intentions and desires were. It's a hard thing to do, but we kept thinking about what happens on the other side when this person doesn't need their organs anymore. And what a miracle it is that we can do these types of surgeries and save people's lives. And he saved the eyesight of people, he saved the lives of several other people, and has made their lives much more comfortable. And that has brought us, especially after a young person dies of suicide, it is so painful that it's hard to explain. It's super painful. But I thought about, and I know Rick and John did too, thought about maybe that will make us feel better about all this a year down the road when we find that there may have been a success story of a transplant, you know, that really changed somebody's life. And by the grace of God, one person who received a kidney, he was only 28 years old, and he had been on dialysis so much that he basically didn't have a life in his, you know, he was towards the end of his days. And now he has decided to correspond with us. And I have to say that that is a silver lining, not just for him, but for us as a family.
I would add that it really, for me, I changed careers after Jack passed. Took 6 months off, and we as a family decided, you know, we have to share our story because this is the path we don't want anybody to walk down. So it really has opened up for us a dialogue around this whole issue of suicide, particularly for young people. It's a very complicated issue, suicide is. But we do know, to Jeanine's point, is that if we, as a family, whether it's Jack or any of us, can save another life and give somebody else a second chance at life, that's so important. It really does bring some comfort to us. We, of course, never hope and pray we'd be in this position, but we are. And so what can we do to make sure parents are having this conversation with their kids?
Touching on that, what are you guys doing now to provide resources to not only parents and teachers, but to younger folks as well that may be watching this today?
We testified on legislation, mental health legislation for young people. We filmed 40 kids with lived experience and with the Colorado Film Commission, the State Attorney General's Office, and Janicek Media, and we pushed those out. They're really kids, youth talking to youth, and all these kids had lived experience. We also wanted to ask youth, and we did focus groups asking youth, what do you want to talk about it relative to your mental health? And this is pre-COVID. And they said, we want to talk about it. We have issues that need to be addressed and nobody is listening to us. So we said, all right, great. What can we do around that? And they suggested, I said, how about a meeting, a summit? They said, we don't want to sit around and talk for 8 hours. We'd love a summit. We said, okay, so let's do it. So they came up with the name, We Got This. We planned it for August of 2020. Obviously COVID changed everybody's life, including that. So now we'll do it again, October 25th. And it's all being, we're working with clinicians and hospitals across the state and young people, more importantly. And the summit's about youth and for youth, giving them a platform and a voice. They have a voice, giving them the platform because they want to talk about it. We also, one of the things that we, when I transitioned back to the city, fortunately, the city is, and our mayor has recognized the severity of this issue. So I was fortunate and I was able to carry that over into my work at the city. And I'm the suicide prevention administrator for the city today. This can be such a difficult, difficult issue, and so many families want to just close up and heal. We obviously want to do that too, but this issue is so important to us that we as a family, we're going to stand strong and walk down this path together.
And speaking of standing strong, tell us about Jack Strong, your foundation.
After Jack passed, as Jeanine said, an extremely popular kid. About a dozen of his friends, more than that, we had over 1,000 people at his services. But we had a number of his friends that were grieving. They didn't know what to do. They reached out to us, so we invited them over to the house. So they put their phones in a basket, and I said, this is what ad agencies do. We're going to come up with some ideas of what you guys want to do. We're not going to criticize them. We're just going to throw them up on the wall, and we'll figure out which ones we really want to move forward on. So they came up with, and we still have the board, 12 ideas of different things they wanted to accomplish. And one of them was, we want to form a group around Jack. We need to keep his legacy alive for us. And so they formed this group called Jack Strong. You know, it's for Jack and it's for them.
What do you want people that are watching the video to leave feeling or thinking?
I think one thing that Rick and I have learned is that most adults have had dark periods in their lives, like the majority of people in the world. Mm-hmm. So I want people to know that they're not alone. And when people say you're not alone, it's not just a tagline. Really are not alone.
Catastrophic things do happen in people's lives. They do. That's the reality of life. But think about if you can give life to somebody else through something that has happened to you in your life. The gift of life is just something that you have to cherish and share.